Gives me great pleasure to now bring on board Mr. Janmay Sinha, Chairman, India Chairman with BCG Group. Mr. Sinha, good morning. Thank you for joining us. In your latest report, you are talking about how India, in a sense, is going to be part of the $100 billion club, and largely this could be a contribution of technology. Let's be more descriptive about it. Would you like to throw more light on it?
So in the article that I wrote, I talked about the changes in the market cap of the top companies in 2000, 2010, and 2020. And I showed that currently, just the market cap of the top 100 companies is $36 trillion. And Apple has a market cap of over $2 trillion. Now, it's very interesting that, for example, if Apple was to sell its market cap, it could buy the entire GDP of Indonesia and Vietnam. Think about it. So what has happened? You know, what are the segments? Which is the most valuable industrial company today? GE used to be in 2000 with a market cap of 500 billion. Now it doesn't even have a 100 billion market cap. And the market cap of Tesla is more than the combined market cap of Toyota, Honda, BMW, and Daimler. Imagine that. Imagine that. This is the change that is taking place. And what is really fascinating in this, and why I really doffed my hat to TCS, is that in one of the most competitive market segments in the world, IT services, it is now the global market segment leader, where it has pipped Accenture and IBM to be the leader. And in a competitive market with all the issues, unlike what is happening in China, if you look at the Chinese companies, you know, whether it is Alibaba or Tencent, or if you look at their banks, ICBC or ACBC, they have all been protected by the Chinese government. TCS has not. And so it is really true that if we say that China was really galvanized, catalyzed, allowed to grow from $1 trillion to $8 trillion in 10 years because of US betting on China, allowing it to enter WTO, bringing it part of their supply chains, shifting their manufacturing to China, 2020, we have a chance if we take it to be able to create a US-India partnership in technology for the next decade or two and create for India a great future in this space, which is going to be the growing space in multiple industry segments and also be very beneficial for the US. Just think of it, Microsoft and Alphabet and Google are run by Indians. You know, first generation, they all went from India to the US. Adobe is run by Shantanu Narayan. I mean, just think of it, that there are first generation Indians who are having to go out of India to build these partnerships, I mean, to get to achieve their full potential. This is the moment when we have to, with a single-minded devotion, create a partnership with the US, which sees India really unlock itself in the decade ahead of growth.
Sure. Mr. Sinha, this, you know, absolutely, it sounds like we're on the verge of, you know, of inflection or major leap going forward. What are some of the other sectors apart from technology that you really see this opportunity in, whether it be logistics management, consumer retail, across the board, really, how do you see the pattern evolving and, you know, this benefiting some of the other segments of the economy for a larger, broader-based move as well?
So firstly, let me just turn that question a bit. Who is disrupting retail?
Sure.
Amazon. And what has Walmart done? Bought Flipkart. Who is disrupting automobile? Tesla. What I'm trying to say is that now technology is embedded in every segment, whether it is industrials, whether it is fintech, whether it is retail. You know, what I'm saying is that there is a fundamental change. There are big tech platforms And then there are companies which have embraced technology. So to say, which are the other sectors, you know, what is financial services going to be? You know, which is the, think about it, which is the most valuable financial services company today? After Berkshire Hathaway, it is Visa. After Visa, it is MasterCard. What happened to the banks? Where are they? Let's look for them. And then you will find JP Morgan Chase, and there is Bank of America. Then there are a few Chinese banks and a Chinese insurance company, which have the protection of the Chinese market. Just see the change that is taking place in the world. That is why I feel that we have to redefine your question. We have to read all the changes, transformations that are coming in are coming from outside segment boundaries. You know, financial services will be reshaped, but not by a bank. It'll be reshaped by somebody entering the bank. You know, where does Tesla employ people from? Think about it. Apple, Microsoft, Oracle. I mean, just think, they are not hiring from other ICE, you know, internal combustion engine companies. They are hiring from technology companies. So we have to really, you know, if banks want to do personalization, for example, should they learn from HSBC or Citi, or should they learn from Facebook and Google? You know, Facebook and Google are now facing the problem in the US Senate, saying that they are using data poorly, you know what I mean, or intrusively. And that is a good debate. We must have it. This is where you should participate. Our consent layer is right there at the top. You know, India has had inflection points in the past, which is it has refused to take. It is important for India to take this inflection point, because the geopolitics of the next 20, 30 years is going to be very different. So we have to marry geopolitics with geoeconomics, and we should be fast at doing it. And just the old, you know, mental models of the past of non-alignment, this, that, the other, we really have to challenge to understand what is the form of alignment we need to serve the best interest of 1.2 billion Indians, to be able to live better lives, and to actually also be able to influence the nature of the value system in the world. I trust me, if you ask a person in America, where would they rather live? In which country? If they couldn't live in the G7, they would prefer to live in India than some of the authoritarian regimes. We need to recognize that that's a great soft power advantage. And, you know, it is this time, it is this important moment when we really need to say, what are the things we need to allow this partnership, which will be all encompassing. You know, it will enter into other newer and newer segments. You said logistics. How will logistics change? Think about it. You know, this whole area of mobility, how will it change? What will be the new ecosystems around mobility? You know, will it be, what type of power will it be? Will it be hydrogen? How will we think about it? I mean, I really tell you, the one thing that has changed in the world, which has really changed in the world right now, is how completely, as a foundation, you need to have technology and data. You cannot ignore it anymore. We need to have the regulations, and we need to have progressive, forward-looking legislation which can understand. We can play a good part in it. You know, we need to see how to protect individuals. We don't want the polarization that engagement requires. All these advertisement-based models of Facebook and Google require continuous engagement. They need you to get up and check your Facebook and send them, that you can keep being bombarded with advertisements. Should we be forcing subscription? Should we be forcing some independent bodies to see what kind of advertisements are allowed and what kind of information is allowed to be spread? These are very big questions, and we need to be a leader in this space. And we have the talent. You see, we have a lot of poor people, which is a real shame, which we have to address. But India also has a lot of very talented people in this space. And we really need to capture them so that we can play a pivotal role in shaping this agenda in the future.
Absolutely. Take your point on that, Mr. Sinha. Great to have you on the show. Thanks for taking the time out and joining in today.